Hi, welcome to Street Priest Ministries. I'm your host, Brother Jay, where we're taking the gospel back to the streets. Today's drive-through message is, Thou Hypocrite. Turn in your Bibles to Matthew 6:41. Matthew 6:41. And why thou beholdest the mote that is in thy brother's eye? A mote is a tree or a beam that is in thy brother's eye, and perceiveth not the beam that is in thy own eye, the splinter. Excuse me. You have a tree in your eye, and you're looking at the splinter in your brother's eye. Either how canst thou say unto thy brother, Brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine eye, when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye? So if I have a tree, a giant tree that's in my eye, how can I see clearly, Jesus has said, to pull a splinter, something small? I got something big going on in my life that I'm hiding from others, obviously, because of just what the word is, hypocrite. But I don't perceive, but I'm going to treat my brother for his splinter that he has. This little small problem, but I got a huge problem that I'm not disclosing to anyone. But on the surface, it looks like I'm okay. Once I go around and judge my brother with his splinter in his eye. This is Jesus talking, by the way. And he said, Thou hypocrite, cast out first the beam out of thine own eye. That's where I titled this, Thou Hypocrite. Focus on you. Focus on your problems before you go ahead and try to help someone else while you're hiding your bigger problem, and focus on your brother or your sister with his or her problem. Thou hypocrite, cast out first the beam out of thine own eye, then thou shalt see clearly to pull the mote out of thy brother's eye. Now this is Jesus talking about hypocrites, some Jesus hated most. Yet in his day, his religious critics, the Pharisees, Sadducees of his time, and they were the ones constantly judging, constantly criticizing. Pharisees had been so corrupted with the law and blinded by legalistic restrictions they put on others and didn't see. That's what happens when you're busy judging, putting down others. We overtly hate what we secretly are. Even in psychology, they say what you usually accusing another of, you guilty yourself. I don't know if it's whitehead or the only one of them guys there. So that's just our nature. And to distract from your own problems, you're busy accusing and putting down people for their problems. Now, the word hypocrite is hypocrisies. It comes from the Greek plague rites of its day, where an actor would come on stage and he'd put on a mask and he'd hide behind his mask. And while he was behind his mask, he put down the audience that was sitting there. Behind his mask he hid. While he behind the scenes did the same thing he was putting others for. Putting others down for. That's where the word Hippocrates come from, hypocrite, that Jesus talked about. Now, one thing I've always hated in my life is a hypocrite. Being raised in around a religious family and the community and going to church as a little kid, I think God let me see a lot of hypocrisy in the churches, specifically, since that's where I was. I remember a famous pastor, I don't name drop, I'm not going to drop his name, but famous pastor, I happened to see as a kid. And he just preached on the evils of marijuana and condemned everybody to hell for smoking marijuana. And I just happened to, I was a kid, I liked to explore, so I just happened to sneak backstage. And what did I behold? The pastor taking a hit of a joint himself backstage. And this is the kind of stuff I saw all the time. You know, I learned early on as a kid something vehemently a preacher was condemning. You go behind closed doors, you find him doing it. If it was adultery, I'd make a bet with myself he's going to get caught in a scandal with adultery. If it was homosexuality, guarantee you, that skeleton's going to leap out the closet as well. And I've been pretty much on the mark most of my life in regard to these hypocrites. And they were, as they were condemning others, they were secretly doing it worse themselves. Now, we're going to let Jesus preach. And we're going to start here. And we're going to stay in Matthew 6. And we'll go back to Matthew 6, 20. And we'll start reading here. I'm going to let Jesus preach. It said, blessed, I'm going to start in the middle of the verse. Blessed be ye the poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate from your company. When you come, this is one thing I don't preach. I don't preach candy land for Jesus. You know, we're going to get sugar-coated cookies and ice cream. And I don't preach that kind of Christianity. I preach a Christianity, come to God, all hell's going to break loose. Come to Christ and bear the cross like Jesus said. People are going to separate from you. You're going to lose. You're going to be hated. Well, that's what Jesus said. He said, blessed are you if you're hated. Without a cause. But see, those that are full of the devil and got to and working for him on his team are going to come against you. And there could be some friends in your circle, family, but God, what he takes from the left will give back to the right, I found out in life. But come to God, I don't preach a featherbed Christianity, a sugar-coated Christianity. I preach the cross. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate from your company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil, for the Son of Man's sake, for Christ's sake. You might be shunned. Rejoice ye in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. Shall you serve men or shall you serve God? Who should your popularity contest be? Popularity contest should be with God or should it be with men? See, we got too many men pleasers. We got too many men pleasers in today's so-called Christianity. They want to be loved. Jesus said you'll be rivaled and hated without a cause. We all want to be loved. We want to be embraced. It's just human nature. But if you come and you're doing it Christ's way, expect rejection. Christ was rejected. The chief was rejected. All the good things he did, the miracles, the healing of people, feeding of the 3,000, 5,000. When it came down to the cross, who was standing there? Everybody forsook him, including his own disciples. It was his mother, Mary Magdalene, I believe, and maybe his sister, and John, the apostle, was the only one that stood by his cross. Everybody abandoned. It's a servant above the master. Christ is our master. God is our, and the angels is our audience. So who are you going to please? But woe unto you that are rich, for ye have received your consolation. Woe unto you that are full, for ye shall hunger. Woe unto you that laugh now, for ye shall mourn and weep. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you. A I'll read that again. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you. If you're doing something for God in his kingdom, or if you just stand out and go out on truth, for truth's sake. But Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. He is the truth. But if you're just doing something that go against the grain, you're going to be rivaled. You're going to be hated. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you. Jesus said, woe unto you when everybody loves you. For so did they the fathers to the false prophets. I've taught on that. You can get the teaching on the false prophets. They love to be loved. Oh, the false prophets, they can fill a stadium. Oh, they love me. Men run up, hug them. They love them. They're men pleasers. I guarantee you, let Brother Jay into a stadium. I only empty it in probably 2 seconds flat. Come in with a cross right behind him. Jesus said, blessed are you when people separate from each other. But he said, woe unto you those when everybody loves you. You don't hear this kind of teaching. Why? It's the way of the cross. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you. For so did they the fathers to the false prophets. But I say unto you which hear, love your enemies, do good to them which hate you. I have come a long ways there, but I still ain't told it yet. Bless them that curse you, and pray for them which despitefully use you. I'm getting better at that. Check that one out. And unto them that smiteth thee on the one cheek, offer also the other. Still working on that one? Don't test me on this. And him that taketh away thy cloak, forbid not him to take away thy coat also. Still get better with that one. Give to every man that asketh of thee. And of him that taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. And as you would that men should do to you, do also unto them likewise. For if you love them which love you, what thank have you? For sinners also love those that love them. And if you do good to them which do good to you, what thank have you? For sinners also do the same. And if you lend to them which you hope to receive, what thank have you? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much again, to receive interest. But love ye your enemies, and do good, and lend hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, and ye shall be children of the highest, for he is kind to the unthankful and to the evil. Our God certainly is. There's people that the sun shines on, the rain shines on, they eat every day, they're just purely evil. They're doing every evil under the sun, some evil unmentionable, some they've joined the devil and is doing the evil under his flag. God's still kind to them, allowing them to live, eat, breathe, enjoy his sun, enjoy his earth. Be ye therefore merciful as your Father in heaven is merciful. Judge not that ye be not judged. Condemn not that ye shall not be condemned. Forgive and ye shall be forgiven. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over, shall men give unto your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. That given promise, so many people have run away. Oh, no. Get my teaching on giving. First fruits, tithes, alabaster box. He's talking about that kind of giving. Giving in accordance with God's scripture. The same promise ain't for everyone. It's a conditional. I'm going to teach on just conditional promises. Something you got to do for us in God's blessing or treasure box of blessing of his word to open it for you. There's a certain key that you have to have to open the treasure box. That's not for everyone. I thought that was a sidebar. If you're busy robbing God, you're not getting his blessing. Sorry. And he spake a parable unto them. Can the blind lead the blind? We got a lot of that going on today. Well, a lot of that going on today. Can the blind lead the blind? Shall they not both fall into the ditch? You got prophets, false prophets, coming in the name of their false religions, leading the blind right into the ditch. If a prophet isn't proclaiming Christ resurrected, Christ is the door to eternity. By Christ, through his blood, are we saved? He is a false prophet. I don't care what the faith is in the religion. That's the essence of religion, to believe your belief is right and the other guy's is wrong. I don't have a problem. I have friends of different, personal friends of different religious persuasions. I tell them, if you don't accept Christ, you're going to hell. They say for you, well, Jay, they say, well, Jay, if you don't accept whatever the various of their gods are, their religion, I'm going to their version of hell. So I said, okay, we'll see. That's the essence of religion. It's there. You're right. The other person's wrong. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. He said, I'm the door. And the other, no name under heaven, as Acts 4 says, no man be saved except Jesus Christ. So I stand on that. You stand on whatever you want to stand on, whatever your belief system. I'm going to teach on the major belief systems around the world, the main respected religions, Endure, Forest, an absolute synopsis of the different faiths and why Christianity stands out head and shoulders above the rest. Sorry, that's my tribe. I got to roll with my tribe. I'm down with my tribe. My tribe is Christianity. The disciple is not above his master, but everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. And now we go back to where we started. See how I took you full circle. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, and perceiveth not the beam that is in thy eye? Either how can I say to thy brother, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thy eye, when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite. I took you full circle there. Cast out first the beam of thy own eye. Then thou shalt see clearly to pull out the mote that is in our brother's eye. For a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. For every tree is known by its fruit. For thorns men do gather of figs, nor of bramble bush gather they grapes. Jesus saying, if you got God's spirit in you and you're on point with God's word, but if the spirit stick around enough, Christ is forming your heart by faith. And if the spirit spirits stick around long enough, you're going to bear fruit. You know, I've watched trees grow. I actually planted trees. Watched them grow over the years. And they take a while for a tree to produce fruit. Don't produce fruit right away. The tree's got to grow. It's got to sprout. It's limbs. It's branches. Leaves. And after a while, it buds, and it's a beautiful sight to see a tree bloom and produce fruit. It's always been a miracle to me. And I've had all types of fruit trees. Avocado trees, all types of trees. It's a wonderful thing. So with us. We'll produce fruit in time if the Spirit stick around. And you'll know by the fruits, Jesus said. You'll know a false prophet by his fruit. Most men that are preaching are not preaching the cross. They're preaching a social gospel. That's what forms hypocrisy, or they're preaching legalism. And they painted themselves, like I said, they put on that mask. And where's my mask? They put on this mask, and they go on stage, and they pretend, you know, they got sparks flying out their ass. And they think they walk on water, and they say, you do this and you do that, and behind the scenes, the very thing they're condemning you of and got you believing that these men are so righteous, and they're not. They're sinners just like you and I. What makes them a worse sinner is they're a hypocrite. And that goes for them and their minions that are hypocrites. Judgmental, condemning. And they've reduced God down to their standards. and they're righteous. The Bible says all our righteousness is filthy rags. None to do of good, no, not one. We all are ungodly and unclean. The only thing that's holy in you is God's Spirit if you've accepted it by faith. God imparts His Spirit in you, which is of God, a seed of God. That's holy, yes. But you have a dual nature. You have the flesh to contend with, which is your natural man, and you have God's Spirit in you. So for you to put on a mask and go around and condemn others, Jesus loathed that. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaketh. I just taught, I took you to Jeremiah 17, I believe, where it talked about the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. We are corrupt according to deceiving desires. It's none of us that do good. We're born in sin. There's no good in our nature. Even the good that you think is self-serving and self-seeking and ungodly, in a sense, it seeks to please self. The very good that you think is corrupt. That's why Paul said, who should deliver us from this body of death? I thank God through the power of God's Spirit in us. That's what shall deliver us. Dunamis. Where we get the word dynamite, the power of God to set you free. Jesus said, He the Son to set free is free indeed, free from your own nature. You got the world, the flesh, and the devil to contend with, and your own nature is an enemy too. So, people that's truly born of the Spirit and of God understand it. But you got people that is in the flesh, operating out of the flesh, and got a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, the Spirit. They're the ones that Christ is addressing as the hypocrites. And hypocrisy takes forms in many different religious belief systems, and not just Christianity. Any form of Mount Sinai, the devil has many forms of. Trying to keep the law, trying to be perfect, and while you put that mask on, you're condemning others. Jesus said, "In a good and an evil man out of the evil heart of his treasure bring forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh." Comes from the heart. Here. You speak it forth. Believe me, when people tell you something, listen very carefully. They're telling you from the abundance of their heart how they really feel. That's why I don't deal with quote-unquote so-called constructive criticism. I know it's, in its essence, it's destructive in nature. The Bible does say open rebuke is better than secret love. I deal with rebuke out of love, but not criticism. Slight difference. Open rebuke is better than secret love. Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but a kiss of an enemy is deceitful. My enemy's going to come with constructive, quote-unquote, criticism, tear you down. And once again, that falls under hypocrisy. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man that built a house and diggeth it deep, and laid the foundation on a rock. And just did the teaching on four great prophets. Christ is referred to as the rock. Moses was told to strike the rock once, symbolizing his death, and the water came forth. Water symbolizes the spirit of life. Something, his death of dead object bringing forth life. The cross brought forth the spirit, symbolizes the spirit, the water of life. When the flood arose and the stream beat vehemently up on the house, and could not shake it, for it was founded up on the rock. But he that heareth and doth not is like a man that is without a foundation built in house upon the earth. Against when the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell. The house was referring to the soul. saying you build on time and things of sand here. Anything, any false belief system, religious system on your own self, family, anything. Anything you build on other than Christ, doesn't matter what it is. Remember I taught on the word faith. You can get that teaching. The time, just trying to remember the title of it. But I had taught on faith already. And the word faith, pisteo, was God, the word God claimed, my action word, not belief. So you have faith in God and build on the rock, which is Christ, your soul. You'll be saved. You build on anything else in time and earth and any other belief system, you're going to hell. Period. That's what Christ is saying. Build his house up on the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell. And the ruin of the house, the ruin of the soul, was great. My friends, don't be a hypocrite. Live a truthful life. Taught on, get the teaching on the age of lies. That's a full form of lying. Lying to yourself. Be honest and true in your convictions. I preach Christ and live my own convictions. I preach Christ. I preach that you come to God, he can change you. Power of the Spirit. I live my own convictions. You do the same. All you judgmental hypocrites out there and want to put on a mask and condemn others. Remember that finger that you're pointing. Probably 10 pointing back at you. Now, I wouldn't be true to the street priests or Brother Jay if I didn't mention with this ministry supported with your tithes, first fruits, alabaster box. God bless you and have a great evening in Christ.